Okay, it looks like we are live. So you guys have to let me know in the comments down below where you come from and what current issues you are having. I have both houseplants in front of me and garden plants. So we're gonna be going through issues that you can see indoors that are disease, bacterial, fungal, and viral issues that may occur on your plants, both indoors and outside. If you're new to the Lee Valley Livestream and you do not know who I am, my name's Ashley and I have a degree in soil science with my major's in soil science, my minor is plant science. So what I like to do is take all of that science and apply it to plants, both indoors and outside. And I scrounged my entire yard for pretty much every single example I have, combined with one of the grafts that we did early in the year. If you guys watched the grafting live we did, this is one of the examples of that you can see. If you are in a very hot climate currently, you have to let me know. Saskatoon is currently 30, which is shockingly warm today, but it's been relatively cool here. And so because of that, we don't see as many issues when it comes to, in particular, fungal and bacterial. But you guys have to let me know. Thomas, hi, how are you? Welcome, welcome. What are your disease issues in your garden, Thomas, or your houseplants? Either or, I have both. Have a little bit of both. And we're gonna help you guys identify what those look like. We usually have Americans here, Canadians, and you guys actually, who are joining the live chat now, pretty much have my undivided attention because normally the chat is just filled with questions, filled with people, but you guys are quiet slash not as many of you. I think people are on holiday, so. But we will get hello from Sask. Excellent chance. I really like that. Twitch. You're from Twitch. Yeah, that's right. Excellent chance. You've been here before. Hello, hello, Twitch. Twitch always turns up. You guys always show up for the fun and games. One time you guys rated. Anyone on Facebook and YouTube watching, you may not know this, but sometimes they do raids. Anyways, we ended up in a Twitch raid. It was a ton of fun. The chat combo was a ton of fun. Good times. So I am going to start because I have probably a dozen-ish plants in front of me. And we're going to go through, first off, how to diagnose these and some of the different issues that I am encountering or have found. How to treat them if you're in an active issue. And then some preventative maintenance you can use as well. So okay, so with Thomas back, it said that the biggest problem he's ever had is yellow asters in flax. Oh, you're growing flax. That's so cool. Thomas, is that a cover crop that you're doing? Or is that like just decorative? Anyone who drives around the countryside, who's maybe not necessarily in agriculture, it's a very pretty purple flower and they are very tall plants, like very, very tall plants. Anyways, they're very, very gorgeous. We have Betty Barnes from South Ontario. The cukes are shriveled up and dried and crispy. Zooks are suffering from powdery mildew and tomato leaves are yellow and crispy and brown. You know what? I have your issue here in front of me and I have your solution as well, Betty. So we will get into that. We have Tracy Kuznick from Oak Bank, Manitoba. Oak Bank, Manitoba. I think that's the first time I've heard that here on the chat. So that's awesome. We have hello from Richmond, Quebec. Never would I think there'd be a more English sounding city or town in Quebec than Richmond. That's kind of cool. And then, oh my goodness, we have probably the most French sounding Manitoba city or town ever. Bourgeois, Manitoba. We have Larry from Vancouver, BC. Hello, Larry. How are you? You probably live in one of the most beautiful, beautiful cities in all of Canada. Excellent chance. Twitch has a fun community spirit for the most part. You guys do. You definitely do, especially when you turn up here on the Lee Valley Lives. Susan says, I hate powdery mildew. Who doesn't? Who doesn't dislike it? But I'm actually going to give you the solution to powdery mildew, backed by science, that will help you in the future for years and years to come. Takes both prevention and treatment to kind of get the powdery mildew under control. Tracy says that her tomato leaves are also browning. So we got lots of tomato leaf browning, which is sounds par for the course. So we'll be able to treat that because I do have those here in front of me. And most of these are kind of the same. So I'm going to get started. I can see your guys' chat. So if you're tuning in from YouTube, Twitch, Facebook, be sure to leave the questions down below. I may not answer them within that moment, but I do get to all the questions in the live chat right away, right straight up front. So do keep that in mind. We have smaller groups right now, so I definitely am getting to everyone's questions at this time. It's usually in the winter time where I'm a little bit rushed and I can't get to everyone's issues. So Terry's saying that he has holes in most of the leaves of his hostas, as well as some other plants. I'm not sure if this is a disease or insect. So Terry, what I think you have is maybe slugs, snails, or some sort of caterpillar. I would encourage you to watch at night to see what's happening, and then actually flip the leaves over top and bottom, take a look at what's going on there, and see if you can see anything. Green would be, assuming a caterpillar problem, or it could be slugs and snails. If it's slugs or snails, I would encourage you to watch the last live stream we just did. They're all archived, so you can find them on Lee Valley's YouTube, Facebook, or Twitch. And in that, we discuss slugs and snail prevention, and one of which is copper, which is the most effective way to treat them, combined with nematodes. So it's something you can add to the soil. You can't see them, but they work very, very effectively. So okay, so we're gonna get started. I wanna get through all the leaves I do have, and then just some maintenance that you guys can use. This guy here is one of the pepper plants, the habanero jalapeno cross that we did. If you guys were here for that live, you know that we grafted some peppers. And so this is one of them. I have jalapenos on this half, and then I have habaneros on this half. Now my habaneros are just starting to flower, and that would make sense because that was the one that was really stressed in that video, because that's the one that we cut and then grafted onto this plant. But the jalapenos are coming in very, very nice. But one thing I did want to show you guys is kind of what these leaves look like. So you guys have to tell me in the chat down below if you can see this kind of dark green to light green and the difference there, because this is something that can happen in potentially potted soils, for example, like what I have in this case. So one thing you can test for, one reason that we would get lighter green leaves, would be an excess of nitrogen fertilizer. So one really great way to tell if that is the issue and it's not a disease and it's a fertilizer issue, because some of these will present very similar to one another, is to actually touch the leaves and give them a little squeeze. If the leaves kind of fall in on themselves and they're very light and very flexible, and they feel like they're not going to break if you made, you know, side to side touch each other, then this is a kind a sign of excess nitrogen, either in the form of compost or manure or in synthetic fertilizer. So that would mean you just have to simply cut back on that nitrogen. Now that's not the case here because I do have very firm leaves. So then the next question would be, a calcium or magnesium issue can also cause kind of these really light leaf colors. So if we look at the fruits that I do have, there's no burr, also known as blossom end rot, which can be a sign of calcium or magnesium deficiencies, which is not typical in a pH soil that's neutral outdoors, but can be common in potting soil, in particular if we are reusing our coconut coir or our peat. So in this case, we don't have deformed leaves and we don't have the burr on the bottom, meaning that we're not suffering from necessarily calcium magnesium issues. Now, the next thing that we want to look for on the actual plant itself is the veins. Are the veins a different color than the leaf? And we can see it a little bit more pronounced on these leaves here, but the basis of this is that the leaves are yellow and the stems or the veining inside are dark green. And so ultimately what this is likely a sulfur or an iron deficiency, a combination of the two. Now, what's going to save this plant is not necessarily more fertilizer. The reason being is because the sulfur and the iron that are naturally in fertilizers, organic or otherwise, are likely in the soil, ready to go, but the pH is not in an ideal range, so it's not able to actually release it. Now, iron, calcium, magnesium, nitrogen, sulfur, all these things actually help the plant prevent against disease, bacterial, fungal, viral, you name it, and kind of beef it up. It's the equivalent of an immune system. And so this plant currently has a weak immune system, so it's more susceptible to potential issues. And I'm starting to actually see that on the plant. So I'm starting to see things like pitting, which I'll show you a little bit closer up of the leaves here in a little bit. I'm starting to see browning, blotching, kind of signs of blight. So one of the best ways to help turn this plant around is actually to use a foliar spray. So you can get iron sulfate sprays. You can get a copper spray, which we'll talk about here in a little bit. But the goal here is to get the nutrients to the plant as quick as possible. On the bottoms of plants, there's like these tiny little mouths located all over the leaves. And what these mouths do is they open up to allow CO2 in. This is why a greener planet helps with climate change, is because it removes carbon dioxide out of the air into the plant and eventually into the biomass and the soil. It's carbon sequestrating. You have to let me know in the comments down below if you've heard of what that is. But what ends up happening when that stomata opens is there's other nutrients that travel past that barrier into the plant, some of which can be applied onto the leaves. So if we use a spray, in this case, I can use a copper grow, which is great immune defense as well. It actually, you know, gives that plant a little bit of a immunity to some issues, is I can spray the plant down. And when we spray, we want to spray both the tops of the leaves and the bottoms of the leaves as well. So when those stomata do open up, which will happen here when the sun goes down, there's no threat of high heats or high intensity of sun. The plant knows I'm not going to lose that much water if I open up my stomata. The stomata will open and those nutrients will rush in. So you want to actually apply the foliar application in the evenings or very early mornings, depending on if you're an early bird or a night owl. So after we do the immune defense on a plant that's showing some immune issues, we can help this plant recover. Now, it should only take for a foliar application to actually work and get the wheels greased, it should only take about 3 to 4 days. So this guy will see a turnaround here very quickly. I noticed the issue about a week ago, and so I did give it a spritz here about a week ago, and it's gotten quite a bit better. So the yellowing that you're seeing now is not nearly as severe as what it was. It actually was quite far down into this area here. So all these leaves that are dark green are starting to revert and come back to a little bit happier medium. So we have Linda saying that, is it possible to grow turnips without using pesticides? Tries the last two summers with no success because of cutworms. So Linda, what I would actually do with cutworms is I would use nematodes. Google nematodes for cutworms and a whole host of products are going to pop up. You want to get the species specific to cutworms and you want to apply that right now this summer. The reason for that is because those nematodes, which you cannot see, will go in and they will eat those cutworms away. The other option here is to use the coffee tin containers that I showed in the last live stream and actually dig those in pretty far around the plant roots, and then that will actually protect that plant, depending obviously on how many turnips you're doing. But ultimately I would give the nematodes a shot and I would start this year right now as a preventative maintenance. So we have Mary, her leaves are turning yellow on her peppers. So Mary, is it the top leaves, such as what we're seeing here, or is it the bottom leaves that are causing the issue? Because if it's the bottom leaves, that's a nitrogen deficiency, and that's not a micronutrient deficiency, such as what we're seeing in this case. We have Clara joining from Beaconsfield, Quebec. Betty Barnes, my beans are doing all right. They have yellow leaves with green veins. The plants are old. So again, this is a sign of potentially yellow leaves, of a micronutrient deficiency. Brina Gravis, we have an empty planter box that is quite large with no bottom. We want to grow the veggies next year rather than filling it in with soil. What else can we place on the bottom of the plant? We have a bit quite large. Oh, I would just, I would do leaves. I would watch the composting series that we just did with Lee Valley Tools. It's in the summer catalog, and I would utilize that and look at the leaf mold video in particular, and I would utilize the leaf mold in this case. So you can actually, again, start that this year, and it will be ready for next. Big guy C in the house. There's Twitch again. Oh man, I always miss the good classes. all the time. Okay, so other than the yellowing of leaves, another one that we can commonly see is something similar to this. So this is a potato plant leaf that we see here, and you can see there's like a pitting in that combined with a yellowing and browning. So this is a potential sign for blight. Now, blight is common across all plants, and they all kind of look very similar to this. The thing is that it's a bacterial infection that is commonly caused by excess moisture. So in Saskatoon, we've been having rain and rain and more rain combined with high heats, and so it can amplify or make blight worse. And so we can expect this to happen. Unfortunately, there's not necessarily any cure to this once we do see it. The only prevention we can really truly use is actually decreasing the exposure to humidity and excess heat. And I mean, in an outdoor environment, it's near to impossible to do. So that is something to keep in mind there. You have to let me know if you guys have seen blight on your plants. It's very, very common. So the next one that I have is a celery leaf. So this, you can see there is pretty much like dark green veins with like brownish in the middle. You can see, you know, it's quite a bit different looking in regards to the plant or what it should be looking like. It should look like celery, and it doesn't currently. So this here is what we would, you know, initially think as sunburn. And when I first saw it on some of my leaves, I did think that it was sunburn. But what this is caused by is actually aphids. So aphids will come in, move onto the leaves, the stem, and they will be sap suckers. And with the sap sucking, ultimately what happens is we lose some of that color and ultimately the health of the plant. Now, this isn't necessarily disease, but it looks very disease-like, in particular because you can't see any pests on the leaves right now. It's pretty much bare looking, but I do know it's aphids because I saw them on here later in the year. But if I stumbled upon this now per se, maybe I didn't notice it at first, I would initially think that this is a disease issue, but it's not. So one of the best preventions for this is going to be ladybugs. You can buy ladybugs at many different greenhouses. Sometimes cities will actually give ladybugs away for free. And so I would go grab those to take care of this, but this is not a bacterial or a fungal issue. One thing that looks very similar to this that we can sometimes see in plants is called the mosaic virus. And so it typically is a little bit whiter. It's more on the whiter side of things. And so mosaic virus ultimately is a virus that can be transported by plants rubbing on each other or from pests such as aphids landing on the leaves, sap sucking, and then transferring the virus that they took from this plant onto another plant. So if you're noticing this mottling or almost like variegation in the plant itself, and it's looking like it's spreading across the garden, it's a sign of potentially mosaic virus. So if this is the case in your garden, you most definitely want to make sure that you're using different tools indoors compared to outdoors, because this will move across plants. It's very non-biased as to who it infects. It will affect anyone and everyone. So something to keep in mind there. You guys are so quiet. Holy moly. That's okay. So next one up is this cucumber leaf. I'm going to get him out of the way because he's starting to go floppy on me. Actually, no, I think this is spaghetti squash leaf is what this is. So on this leaf, we can see ripping and tearing. We can also see kind of like this yellowing, like these yellow kind of pits or markings. We can see them on the bottoms of the leaves. And this yellowing kind of pit-like attitude is actually just a sign of damage. So this guy is trellising up one of the trellises I have in my backyard. And with that, it's getting knocked around in the wind. It's rubbing against that chicken wire. And what ends up happening is it ends up rubbing on the leaves, which ultimately is affecting the outer edge, the cuticle, I guess you could say, of the plant itself, which ultimately can damage chlorophyll or some of the cells that chlorophyll travels in. So again, this isn't necessarily, you can see like a really good example here up on the corner, kind of like a yellowing or browning. This is just a sign of what we call mechanical damage. So again, it's not necessarily disease. It's not bacterial. It's not viral. It is a mechanical damage. Now, one way to know if this was, you know, a rust, for example, it's very similar to rust spot, is when it's not uniform and it's kind of intermittent throughout. And it also is in odd areas. So whether it be on the trellis or it's on the pole or if it's in a high traffic zone, you're noticing one half of the plant is a little bit damaged. That is a sign of potentially mechanical damage rather than an infection. But you will want to keep your eye on it to see, make sure that it doesn't spread. So we have Renee's wondering if I have potato blight. This morning I saw one of my plants had yellow leaves, my first time growing potatoes. So my question for you, Renee, is when was the last time, or when did you plant these? Was it, you know, mid-May, end of May? If so, they may be ready. They may be ready to harvest here. And that's why they're beginning to yellow. If it's you planted them later, then it may not be ready to harvest and it's likely a nitrogen issue. And then again, is it the top leaves? Is it the outer leaves or is it just the bottom leaves? Let me know in the comments down below because I'll be able to give you a little bit more guidance on what that could be. Amy from California, Cetacea mandarin replanted into half wine barrel a couple months ago. Older bottom leaves are yellow or to brown. New growth is green but tightly curled onto itself on one side of the leaf. The leaves are not fully developing. Amy, I would look into, sounds like you have a couple things going on here. Your pH of your soil, your potting soil is, I'm assuming what you're using or your regular soil. The pH sounds like it's off. So I would actually get that pH tested. You can just get at home kits for that. Actually, I think Lee Valley actually sells a kit for that, but I would test that pH, make sure it's at a 6.5. If it is above that or below that, and then adjust accordingly with either lime or elemental sulfur or garden sulfur. And then it sounds like you could have a calcium deficiency combined with a nitrogen deficiency. So I would treat for that accordingly. If it is a calcium deficiency, I would encourage you to go with a foliar application to try to turn that down around as quickly as possible. So Dina is asking how to get rid of clematis blight. Okay, so I will get back to you on the solution for that. I have a couple for you actually to take care of the blight. Adam Clark, what's the best way to get rid of cucumber beetles? Mechanical removal is the number one way to get rid of them currently this year. In the future, however, they do overwinter in plant debris, in mulch and in soil. So you will want to consider actually removing the mulch and the soil from infected areas and then using proper crop rotation whenever possible. Because they overwinter, there's a number of actual different plants out there or diseases and pests that overwinter. Some include, you know, thrips, cucumber beetles, potato beetles, flea beetles, you name it. So actually, you know, removing the infected areas and garbaging them rather than composting them is going to be key. So we have Karen King, is the same yellow on the bottom with tomatoes, too much rain. Yeah, so the yellowing of leaves on the bottom, regardless of what plant it is, it could be a house plant, it could be an ornamental flower, or it could be a vegetable. The bottom leaves yellowing is a sign of lack of nitrogen. 9 times out of 10, it's lack of nitrogen. So the only way you can turn that around quickly is to use fertilizer. Nitrogen does not move well through the plant as a foliar application. So I would encourage you to use something that has nitrogen in it to help turn that around. If you have lots of rain, the only other option or the only other worry would be for an anaerobic environment or a rotting environment where the pH can change, which can cause something called chlorosis. So I would Google chlorosis and see if that image looks really similar to the images that you're seeing on your tomato plants and then adjust accordingly. I don't have any chlorosis in my garden, otherwise I would have shown you an example of that, but it does look very similar to this. However, it's usually the entire plant and not just the top leaves or just the bottom leaves specifically, it'll be the plant as a whole. Send some rain east from Saskatoon. Yeah, that's, it depends on where you are in Saskatoon. Some places Saskatoon have flooded, some places haven't. We have Kevin, honeysuckle, powdery mildew sprayed, copper fungicide, with some relief, Duxbury, Massachusetts. Okay, we'll talk about powdery mildew here in a little bit. I don't have any examples of it, unfortunately. I was hoping for some for this video. It's kind of, when we were planning this, you know, in way back when, I was guesstimating powdery mildew issues right now, which is usually when we have them, but it's been so cold here where I am, so surprise, there is none. And a lot of fungal and bacterial issues amplify more and more over time with heat, and so because of our lack of heat, I'm not seeing a lot here today. Peony leaves have developed dark brown spots. What could this be? That sounds like black spot. I would Google black spot, Clara, for that. I have blister beetles destroying my garden this year. Again, for a lot of these beetle species, your only real recourse is diatomaceous earth, removing them physically and sticky traps. So... Mary's saying, I have straw bales around my raised beds. I think I saw beetles living in the straw, which again, a lot of beetles in all different shapes and forms will overwinter inside of the soil. So that is something to keep in mind there. So this here is a tomato plant leaf where I'm starting to get kind of these crisp brown edges. Now this is a sign of blight. This blight, however, is not ransacking my garden by any means, and is very easily controlled by actually pruning away the leaves that are infected and keeping really good airflow. So if you have your tomatoes really densely planted, I encourage you to go in and trim out all your suckers and all your lower leaves to help with airflow and just overall movement of air in that area. So that's what I would do if you're seeing something like this, which is a blight, in particular the crisping around the edges of the leaves. Now, another example of a tomato problem that I have is this, and this is just another example of mechanical manipulation. So you can see kind of this really odd, so this one here actually is a sunburn, but in and around here, you can see the leaves kind of folding in on itself. This was an awkward area where I was trellising and the trellis rope was actually rubbing up against the leaves, and you can see it's done quite a bit of damage. So this isn't a disease. It's a friction burn, basically. Now this here is some more pitting. You'd assume that this would be some sort of a bacterial problem, but this is actually caused by thrips. So I've caught the thrips in action on this. This is a nasturtium, but this kind of look will happen with any plant affected by this. So that is what thrip damage looks like. It does look like a bacterial infection, but how I can tell the difference is the thrip issue is not perfect circles. Whenever we're dealing with bacterial infections, we're usually dealing with perfect circles, and we're not seeing that here in this case. Every year my peonies develop yellow leaves with spots. So it looks similar to this. I have this nasturtium leaf here. I have the yellowing with the brown pits on it. This one here is a different nasturtium. This is a jumbo nasturtium. It's different than the first one I showed you. But this one here is a nitrogen issue. And this ultimately let it become really susceptible to bugs and bug issues in that case. So I want to show you, this is a houseplant. So this is a Hoya. And on the bottom of my Hoya, we can see these little tiny red dots. You guys can see that there. And this is, could be two things. So in this case, this is rust. And the reason why I know that this is rust is because when I run my finger along it, it's raised and bubbled. And so because of that, I can tell that it is something added to the plant, which is a sign of, you know, a disease problem. Now, the opposite to that would be what I'm seeing kind of on the front of these leaves. Very good example, when it's flush to the leaf, and that in this case, it's not specifically that, it's called edema. And so fiddleleaf figs are very famous for having this. And essentially what it is when the plant grows too quickly and it causes a blister in the plant. So the edema is not an issue. It'll go away with time. As the plant gets bigger and things flush out a little bit more, it will disappear. But with the rust, you want to use prevention for that. So I'll talk about kind of different ways we can help with some of these diseases, because I've wrote some of these down here. So the first one is the copper spray. Now I know I spoke about this as a fertilizer and a foliar fertilizer at that, but copper is also used to fight not only slugs and snails, but potential diseases. So the list of fighting potential that this has is powdery mildew, bacterial canker, rust, which is what I just showed you, early and late blight. So if you have tomato blight or potato blight, the copper will help with that. Peach leaf curl and a host of other bacterial and fungal issues. If you can find this, I would just have this on hand at all time, houseplant or gardener. You wanna keep this on hand. And the instructions are gonna be your best bet. So this will tell you to spray weekly in the event that you are delayed in disease, or if you are, delayed in nutrient uptake. But if you're having a disease issue, you would want to spray once every 4 days until the threat of that disease is gone. You can use copper as preventative maintenance. So say you have a known powdery mildew issue or a known downy mildew issue, what you may choose to do is to spray copper onto the plants. Now, this is an incredibly inconveniently small package. You can get copper powder that can be mixed in water on a large scale. And Lee Valley has like the pump style with the hose and then also the hand version. I think the one is 2 liters. I want to say the bigger one is 6 liters, 4 or 6 liters. So that's going to go a long way. And all you would do is once a week, just go through the garden, give everyone a spritz. You're going to foliar, obviously, fertilize, and then you're also going to help prevent against the potential buildup of bacterial or fungal issues in the future. The next one is garden sulfur. So this can come in many different shapes or forms. I've seen it used in a heating mechanism with a puck. So it's a sulfur puck and it has heat from the bottom that emits, warms the puck up, and then it actually fogs out and takes out, for example, I have it written down here, powdery mildew, black knot, rust, apple scab. It also takes out powdery mildew, downy mildew. I've used it actually in research greenhouses before. And so with that, it's a fog. It smells like rotten eggs. So you want to do it at night when your neighbors aren't sitting on their deck. But you can also get a spray version of it, very similar to this, like a liquid spray version. And then you can get a dusting version as well, where you would actually dust the leaves or dust the fruit in those cases. So the next version is earth lime sulfur. So this takes care of powdery mildew, black knot, rust, apple scab, peach leaf curl, powdery mildew, downy mildew, and blight as well. And earth lime lime sulfur, again, can be foliar applied. And if you foliar apply it, it will take care of other nutrient deficiency issues because that lime will contain some levels of calcium as well, which can help prevent against blossom end rot, which can be caused by imbalances in the actual soil pH from the potting soil perspective and then also the in-ground soil perspective. The sulfured lime can also be added to the soil as an amendment. So if you're putting together a raised bed or you're getting ready to close down for the season and you want to amend the soil, you may choose to actually mix that sulfur lime into the soil. It's going to be pretty much pH balanced. So if you are adding it to a soil that's pH is in a 6.5 and it's a little bit out of whack, it can help bring that back into control. So then you won't have these issues the next year. Or if you are in the habit of reusing your potting soil, so I reuse mine, coconut coir and peat, I will actually mix in sulfured lime in with my potting soil every year when I go to reuse it, just in hopes of neutralizing that pH. So I don't wind up with this issue that you can see here. So the other ones, the last one and probably the most interesting version, because we are running out of time here, so make sure you get your questions in, is whey. So I have this here. This is a soon to expire cream that I have. If you can get whey, pure whey, if there's any cheese makers out there, then I encourage you to actually use that whey that you get, like the after whey that you get from making cheese. It works brilliantly. The research on this is actually pretty shocking. So when we apply whey protein to the plant as, again, a foliar application, we can apply it to our compost and we can apply it to our leaves. It helps reduce not only the spores, but the hyphae that come with powdery mildew. So if you currently have powdery mildew issues, I would go into the garden and spray milk. Now you can dilute this 1 cup of milk to 5 cups water, or you can do straight up milk. It's completely up to you. Same with the whey, you can dilute it if you want to. It would be 1/2 cup of whey to 5 cups water in that case. And I use this and it works brilliantly. The research on it is actually pretty interesting if you want to just do a quick Google on that. What happens when whey is exposed to light is it releases a very specific acid, and that acid is actually what ends up degrading a lot of the hyphae and the fungal spores. Which leads me into my last and final statement when it comes to any bacterial disease, any fungal disease, any viral disease, and in some cases pests. I would do a quick Google to see if it overwinters in. If it overwinters in the mulch, if it overwinters in the soil, or if it overwinters in the plant debris, you want to take the necessary precautions needed to ensure that those plant debris do not end up in the actual compost itself. Very, very important, because if you compost it, you're going to spread the spores and the bacterial issue for many, many years to come. Bacteria can be damaged by heat. Powdery mildew specifically cannot be damaged by heat. So if you watch the compost series that just came out with Lee Valley Tools with the late summer catalog, in that I talk about temperature, humidity, and all these different things you need to use to help to control pests and bacteria and that sort of jazz. If you're not able to get it to the correct heats, you definitely don't want to apply that compost. But if you can't, any heat whatsoever will not treat fungal spores. They will survive anything and everything. It's actually pretty shocking. So make sure you throw that in the garbage, no compost whatsoever, because you're just going to amplify the issue for years to come. So we have some time for some questions. Could an aphid infestation cause this to happen? It's happening away. Yeah, so aphids can do quite a bit of damage. Like, I mean, this is caused by aphids. I've got leaf curling, I've got weird malformations, I have leaves turning down sideways, and then I have this kind of loss of color. I have this really crunchy leaf look. This is aphids. This is for sure aphid damage done here. And so this is just a great example of how much damage aphids can actually do. Why are the bottoms of my tomatoes rotten and black? So your tomatoes, what you have is called burr, B-E-R. It's called blossom and rot, and it's caused by lack of calcium and magnesium. Now, it's not lack of calcium and magnesium in your potting soil or your soil. It's lack of the plant's ability to uptake calcium and magnesium from the soil it exists in because the pH is not yet in line. The best way to turn around that ship is again through a calcium magnesium foliar application. If you fertilize, this will not change the issue. It will not reverse the results. You need to foliar apply it. Dina, my Italian parsley has yellow leaves. Again, I would reference the older parts of this video. Is it the bottom leaves or is it the top leaves? That is going to be very important to determine what the issue is there. Tracy is saying that my salvia in several planters, the leaf tips are darkening and turning downward. Bacterial issue. Darkening and turning downward. That sounds bacterial in my... It sounds bacterial, but salvia is usually pretty darn resistant. So, yeah, I don't know. For that one, I'd have to see photos to really see what's going on that. There, Marin, does the whey harm beneficial hyphae from mycorrhizae? So, yeah, Marin, if you are going to apply this to the compost, you would want to do it after you chose to put any mycorrhizal inoculants in place. And you would just want to foliar apply. And I mean, at the end of the day, if you apply it to a compost you know is infected with powdery mildew, for example, just use caution is what it comes down to. You can buy inoculants. Great White Shark is a brand out there that has a ton of mycorrhizal, endo and ecto mycorrhizal fungi in there. I would just re-inoculate the pile. If you can save your pile from exponentially letting more powdery mildew out, then I would do that accordingly. I would treat it for the powdery mildew, and then I would just re-inoculate that compost after and help turn that around for you. Kirsten says, hello from southwestern Ontario. Are all your remedies safe for beneficial insects and pollinators? Oh yeah. I mean, the copper, the calcium sprays, milk, none of these are going to affect any beneficial insects. They're also not going to treat the bad ones either. You're not going to get rid of aphids with whey powder spray. I mean, at the end of the day, and it's not going to harm your bumblebees or anything like that. Nicole, how to start to shift anaerobic soil to aerobic? The plot of land the garden is set up on has become waterlogged on a clay bed. What I would do, Nicole, is I would bring, there's a broad fork. We just did a video on a live stream on this. Beginning of the year, go reference it. There is a device called a broad fork. You'll see me kind of using it. It's a big U with a bar across the bottom with all these pokers through it. You stick it in the soil, you're going to step on top, and then you're just going to lift the soil up. It's going to add some aeration in there, and that will, in and of itself, get things moving. It'll help with aggregation. And then ultimately, if you could incorporate some compost in there, so do a nice, 2 inches of compost on top of that soil, and then go and broad fork that soil within an inch of its life. Maybe put some tillage radishes in. They're just icicle radishes in place. and you're good to go. It should alleviate the problems pretty rapidly. I would encourage you to probably use some lime, powdered lime, garden lime, just to help with pH and aggregation, and you should be made in the shade, and it's a good place to start. Does wine must help keep power? What does wine help to fertilize? No, but wine and vinegar are great weed killers. If you have rocks, or if you have interlocking brick or cement, wine and vinegar, just full dose. If you ever want to get rid of some excess, just dump it on, you're good to go. So, but we are officially out of time. I want to thank you guys so much for joining in on today's live stream. Be sure to check out the future ones we have coming up. There's, you know, we do woodworking every once in a while, houseplants, indoor plants, you name it. And I will definitely talk to you guys next time. And of course, keep sharing the knowledge. I'll talk to you guys later.